you judge this war according to the criteria established by those who are waging war, then it's been a total disaster. A total disaster. Because the Kosovo, for which NATO purportedly went to war, no longer exists. Its cities, its villages have been bombed, destroyed by NATO bombers. Large sections of its population has left. The very people needed to rebuild, to reconstruct, to give it a life after the war are no longer there. Engineers, architects, lawyers, technicians, workers, they've left. And very few of them will go back. Because this is the one thing we do know, that when populations are shifted, moved out, they suffer very deep traumas. And very few of them go back. Maybe in the case of Kosovo, more than 10 or 15% will go back. Maybe. So those who claim that they went to war to help the Kosovan people are lying. That was not the aim of the exercise. The aim of the exercise was to remove and punish a government they did not like and a leader they did not trust for reasons of their own. That is why they went to war. Because all the information coming out now, and not just from people on the left or in the anti-war movement, the stuff published in the American press, much better incidentally than the British press. The New York Times and the Los Angeles Times have published reports repeating that before the talks folded up in Rambouillet, the Serbian government was prepared to accept a United Nations peacekeeping force in Kosovo. They accepted there were problems. They said they were prepared to have a UN peacekeeping force, UN armies. What they were not prepared to accept was an exclusively NATO force. And who can blame them for that? Because this NATO force didn't simply want to occupy Kosovo. In the Rambouillet Accords, they wanted the right to go anywhere they wanted in the Yugoslav Federation without any force, local force, being allowed to stop them. In other words, they wanted to police the whole of Serbia. It says it black on white. So it's hardly surprising that the Serbian delegation at Rambouillet walked out. Unfortunately, that is what they were intended to do. Because when the KLA from Kosovo did walk out for a bit, the Americans dragged them back in and said, for God's sake, if you don't sign these accords, we will not have any occasion to bomb Serbia. So the notion that they were seriously concerned about either a peace settlement or to help the people of Kosovo is just baloney. It just doesn't make sense. All the facts now tell against it. And the way the bombing campaign has been carried on explains it further. I mean, what possible use is bombing Serbia if your main aim is to get the Kosovans back as soon as possible? How does that help? It only helps if your aim is to destroy a local regime which disagrees with you and will not be part of your own plans for the region, to destroy it, to remove all opposition, and to construct a giant NATO base in the region, which they've already done in Bosnia, in Tuzla, and to carry on the process, a Cold War process, of surrounding Russia with NATO bases, which is what this whole exercise is about, in my opinion. This is a NATO war. It's a war for NATO hegemony, and it's a war waged by the United States, who thought it wouldn't last that long. They've always been wrong about that in the past. Wars they think will be over quickly, boys will be back home by Christmas, have a tendency to carry on and on. We know that from the past. But they thought it would be over because they were having a tussle inside NATO with some of the other NATO countries, not Britain, which is always in their pocket, but the Italians, the Germans, the Greeks needed to be convinced that NATO's objectives of being a defensive alliance could be shifted so easily into transforming NATO into an offensive alliance, what they call a zapping organization, which could go and zap the enemy they decide is the enemy anywhere at any time. This was the debate going on in NATO, because prior to this, the Germans, the Italians, the French, the Spanish, the Portuguese had refused to countenance any international operation by NATO unless it had prior UN sanction. The victory of the United States here lay in the fact that they persuaded them to override the United Nations because they feared a Russian and Chinese veto on any such operation. So this is essentially why the war was launched, and a war they thought would last a couple of days because they thought Milosevic or the Serbian government or whoever would capitulate. And that, as we now know, is no longer the case. They are now discussing what to do. And there are two options. One is a ground war, an invasion. So they go in and occupy the whole of Kosovo. The second is an occupation by NATO at the core, as they say, with NATO at the core, but with other countries involved, which would effectively mean a partition of Kosovo. And the third is to return to the United Nations and see if that can be sorted out. I think it's too late myself now for the UN to do anything constructive, but that is a possibility. And so the debate which is now taking place within NATO is whether to try and do a deal with the Serbian government or whether to go in without a deal. And this is where the bombing is important. Because some people who argue, well-meaning people, well, we're opposed to the bombing. We don't like the bombing, but we want a ground war. Lots of people say that, incidentally. Columnists, you know, decent, kind, soft-hearted liberals say, we don't want the bombing. We're opposed to it, but instead they should send in ground troops. But what dream world do they live in? The bombing has a function. The bombing has a function. Its aim is to destroy the people on the ground who would resist ground troops. So when ground troops go in, there's least possible resistance. That's why the bombing is going on. A turkey shoot, they called it, during the Gulf War, where they went and killed so many people that finally lots of pilots couldn't take it. One reason that bombing was stopped was because the pilots said we'd had enough. Going back to what Bruce was saying, they just said we can't go on, and lots of pilots in the Gulf War had breakdowns afterwards because they said just going above large numbers of people and killing them is not something which is normal or human. And so this war is now, I think, reaching a critical moment, which is why the peace movement is so important. And peace movement in warmongering countries like Britain, where the temperature in warmongering is higher than it is in the United States of America today. That's the disgrace, that this new Labour government, from which we didn't expect too much, I think it would be false to say we expected too much from them, but one expected something slightly different from what had happened before. Well, not only have we not had that in education, health, the social services, we've not had that, but you also have a government which is far more of a warmongering government than the major government which preceded it. I mean, that's just a fact, because for Blair, everything is transformed into public relations. And public relations requires the picture of a moral crusade. A leader shown to be in the forefront. Britain is leading the war. We're the tough ones. It's an absolute disgrace. And we're very proud. And we're very proud of people like Alice and the handful of others in the Labour Parliament. But the disgrace is that there aren't more of them. There are 182 members of parliament in the Italian parliament. Most of them belonging to the ruling party have signed a resolution calling for an end to the bombing. The German Social Democrats are severely divided. Public opinion in Germany is shifting. 97% of the population of Greece is hostile to the war. 97%. And the Greek trade unions have openly and publicly warned NATO, if you try and shift your troops through Greece, we will go on a general strike to stop all movement. That's the situation, and here our newspapers and our liberal leader writers and The Guardian and The Observer say, we've got to carry on. And you say, why do you have to carry on? And the only reason now they want to carry on is because NATO can't be seen to lose. Yeah. The aims, the war aims have changed. The first war aims were to save the Kosovan people. I didn't believe them, but they were what they said. Well, it's created a major humanitarian catastrophe, this war, for the Kosovans. Major! It's wrecked that country. Wrecked it. And you know, one shouldn't get totally caught up in these tiny ethnic divides. There are large numbers of people all over the former Yugoslavia. If who you ask them, what are you? They won't say, I'm a Serb or a Croat or a Bosnian or a Kosovan. They will say, we are Yugoslavs, even though the country to which we used to belong no longer exists. That's what we are. And this country was wrecked, and this country was destroyed because the West and the Western powers, especially the European Union in this regard, were totally irresponsible. And that's why it's their responsibility now, having seen how they've wrecked this part of the world, to make sure that the money is available to rebuild it again. But how should it be rebuilt? We're all for giving them billions. But how should it be rebuilt? Who should decide how it's rebuilt? Do we want the Balkans to become a collection of NATO protectorates, new colonies? Look at Bosnia today. 30,000 soldiers, NATO soldiers. Everything is decided by the NATO High Command. There's no democracy worth speaking of. They can sack political leaders. You can elect your own particular leader. He can be sacked tomorrow, or she can be sacked tomorrow by the NATO command, acting through the UN's High Representative. There is no democracy in Bosnia today. And all the information coming out now stresses this. And that is the model they have for Kosovo. This is where the KLA and their supporters will come a crop out. If they think they're going to run the country, they are not. It will be run by NATO, if NATO gets in there. And it's NATO who will determine what happens. So the war is at the present time in a critical stage, and NATO is divided. Everyone knows that. The British press tries to play down reports which stress it, but there are divisions inside NATO. And these divisions are caused because public opinion is very important for these governments. And public opinion in Germany is shifting, and public opinion in Italy has shifted considerably since the war began, and they have to take account of that. And I think, incidentally, that by the time this war is over, governments will fall in Hungary and Bulgaria and Romania, because there is growing anger against these governments for caving into NATO. So, what do we do? What can we do? I think we can try and multiply our forces, because I think opposition here is stronger than seems to be the case if you judge by television and the press. And you know, there's some idiot writing in The Guardian today, Friedland said, oh, this is not Vietnam where everyone was against the war. I mean, the guy is just ignorant. I remember when we started the Vietnam movement, we were in a total minority. Some of you here, I can see, are veterans of that movement, like myself. We were in a minority. When we started off, 20% agreed with us, 80% agreed with the government of Harold Wilson, who was supporting the war. At least he didn't send in the troops, which Blair would have done, but you know, let's not go into that now. So we slowly built it up, and by the time the movement was at its height, I think we had 35% on our side, judging by the opinion polls, 35%. But it was a vigorous and vociferous and strong 35%, which we tried to mobilize. On this wall, we've got 30% already. 30% of the people in this country are opposed to the war. And so we've got to mobilize them to build our strength and to make sure that we demonstrate in force and especially give new Labour members of Parliament a tough time in their constituencies. You don't all, I mean, it'll be great if all of you come to London. I don't want to discourage you, but if you can't for some reason, go into the surgeries of your MPs. Challenge them to a debate. Force them to discuss politics, which they all run away from, because increasingly they're frightened of politics. And the fact that you have people like Robin Cook and Claire Short and George Robertson defending this war in the most disgusting and sickening language is something they will have to live with all their life. This is NATO's war fought for NATO's aims. And this, I will end on this point, that they are now throwing in everything to try and build up their case. So suddenly, the international lawyers they've hired come up and indict Milosevic for war crimes. Suddenly it happens. Incidentally, even in that indictment, he's charged with the murder of 314 people, which may or may not be true. If it is, it's appalling. But 314 people doesn't add to genocide, which is what they've been saying. He's a Hitler. Genocide. He's been, I have no brief for him. He is an elected leader. He's been elected 3 times by his own people. Dictators are usually elected once. They don't go for an election again. So you have to understand that the demonization which goes on, and you know, it's not a case of him being the only type, only sort like that in the region. Tudjman in Croatia, who's worshipped by some of the pro-war people now, like Michael Foot, who thinks he's done no wrong, completely ignored. So we have to be against ethnic cleansing of any sort, of any people. But that includes the ethnic cleansing of the Serbs in the Krajina, which took place and very few people spoke up. Very few people spoke up because of the horrors that were being committed by the Serbs in Bosnia. And we can't afford, as an anti-war movement, to have double standards like that, because that would make us too like the New Labour politicians who are running this country. So I urge you all to try and come to the demonstration. If not this one, the next one, because these demonstrations will continue and they will grow larger and larger till it becomes very difficult for them to ignore our voices and to ignore our strength. But if you can't come, make sure you get active here.